Apogee was truly in full steam in 1994, with a lot of very sleek-looking games being released in quick succession, and a couple of those would become all-time classics. Once again, they opened the year with a vertical shoot-em-up, this time Raptor by Cygnus Studios. And if you compare it to Major Striker, which was released just the previous year, this looks absolutely spectacular. The graphics look like they were imported from 3D renders, and everything has a gritty industrial look that just couldn't have been achieved using the 16-colour graphics of the past. One really nice touch is how everything in the air casts a shadow, which moves position depending on where the ship is relative to the centre of the screen. There's also a soundtrack by Bobby Prince as usual, but it's strangely relaxed compared to the action that's going on screen. For some reason, he chose not to just steal some Metallica songs for them this time. Unlike every other game so far, the story is very unclear. In fact, it's so unimportant that they apparently didn't notice that the last couple of lines of their introduction had been cut off in the printed manual. All the game gives you is that you've been hired by Megacorp to destroy things, and you do this by scrolling up the screen shooting at the several bajillion ships and ground defences coming the other way. That's about all you need to know. The game says the mouse is supported, and I was interested in trying it for more precise control than the keyboard, but I couldn't get it to respond while in-game. Everything feels very reactive. I love how everything explodes as you advance through the levels, with chain reactions making their way through buildings below even as you move on to fight more incoming units elsewhere. Each thing destroyed earns you money, and you'll find additional boosts in the form of ships who drop minerals or floating cash or something, along with bonus pickups that give you large and strangely precise non-rounded amounts of money, perhaps the taxes included. You use this money to keep your own aircraft in the right shape, hole-free, and loaded up with various types of missiles. Between each mission, you have the chance to visit the shop, where a large selection of upgrades are available, including a pretty impressive array of weapons, about 11 or 12 in all. They're divided into weapons that are always on, and ones that are selectable. The selectable ones can further target the ground, the air, or both. You also have a supply of megabombs, shown by the row of radiation symbols in the bottom left of the screen, which do a decent amount of damage to everything on the screen when they're deployed. Unfortunately, they need to drop to the middle of the screen first, by which time anything that's bothering you will be long gone, so they're only really useful if you've memorized what's coming, or if you use them to knock off a piece of one of the boss's health bars. During missions, you don't use the number keys to select these weapons or anything, all you have is a weapon toggle button, and I was about to mention how awkward searching through the vast array of them for your ground missiles is, when I realized I'd just been playing the game wrong my entire life. Nothing is limited ammunition, so you should of course be selling off the weapons that you're replacing rather than keeping them around getting in the way, and this gives you a bit of a cash boost as well. This is a particularly wise thing to do because the differences in cost between adjacent weapons in the shop can be absolutely enormous, meaning that even taking every monetary advantage you can get, you have to hold out for a very long time before being able to upgrade yourself. The game uses an unusual health system for shoot-em-ups. Unlike most other games of this genre, your ship hasn't been built with the fragility of an airborne meringue, and you have what at first appears to be a reassuringly long health bar on the right-hand side of the screen. As you take damage, this gets depleted, with different types of projectiles taking different amounts off. Later on in the game, you'll find the fireballs in particular draining that bar alarmingly quickly, and because the game throws such an overwhelming amount of stuff at you at once, it's very difficult to avoid all damage. Sometimes you just have to rely on your ability to recognise the enemy ship's shadows as they scroll onto the screen in a sort of aviation ornithology that lets you tell what ships it's relatively safe to be shot by. One of the upgrades you can buy is the phase shield, which gives you an entire extra health bar, and you can keep up to 5 of these in reserve at one time. It's expensive, but it's practically the only thing giving you a fighting chance towards the end of the game. During a level, you can recharge your normal shields by letting go of the fire button for a while, but this happens so comically slowly that the feature might as well not be there at all. Another thing that I rather strongly feel shouldn't exist is the way that when you're very low on health, every point of further damage will cause a system failure and remove a randomly chosen weapon permanently. So if you survive the mission after this, you'll have to spend a potentially giant amount of cash to buy them back again on top of the large repair cost. However, if you ever reach the critically low level of health in the game when this starts happening, chances are you're not going to make it through the mission anyway, making all of this something of a moot point. The concept of episodes that had served Apogee so well in the past is altered a little here. You still get 3 regions to select from, but instead of being 3 completely separate sets of levels, you can select one of them at any time and fly your next mission there, switching back and forth as you like. In theory, this allows you some choice as to the order in which you make your way to completing the game, but realistically, the missions of the second and third episode ramp up the difficulty so much that it's far more practical to stick to taking them on from top to bottom. In fact, I still found this too difficult, and so resorted to doing a few laps of the first episode after completing it just to rack up some profit so I could arm myself effectively for the later ones. Overall, the game could really have benefited from some rebalancing of the difficulty, a problem that wasn't evident in the shareware version because you only had the first easiest episode to deal with. One fairly unique thing that Raptor did was that when started up, it would look at the date and recognise when it was one of the programmer's birthdays, whereupon the game went absolutely mental.
You boys just don't get it, do you?
After encountering that slightly alcohol-flavoured reorchestration of the Apogee theme, you would be faced with several new and extremely tough enemies, including monkeys that hurl barrages of coconuts into the air at you, and these robo-cows that open up to fire extremely deadly lasers. I can only imagine how terrifying this would have been to me if it had happened out of nowhere, but fortunately I'd read about how to invoke the date chick in a magazine, if you remember those. Despite its lack of balance in the difficulty department, Raptor is a very enjoyable game, and it even still looks impressive today. At least I think so, but then I am increasingly a relic of a previous era. Now where are my slippers? Hocus Pocus was the sole side-scrolling platformer that Apogee released this year, a sign of changing times if ever there was one. Cygnus Studios are credited again for the graphics, which have a slightly familiar gradient-y rendered look now that I compare it to Raptor, but most of the game was made by Moonlight Software. This time, you play as a young apprentice magician with the appropriate name of Hocus Pocus, who has the ambition of taking a place on the Council of Wizards. The head of the council, Terexin, has given him a series of tasks to complete before he can become a member, all involving capturing a set of magic crystals from their enemies' castles and then defeating them for good measure. During the game, he projects himself astrally into the castles in order to watch what you're doing and be sarcastic. The focus of Hocus Pocus is on finding and collecting the crystals scattered around each level. Each can have any number from about 4 to 8 of them, and you can collect them in any order, then get teleported off to the next level as soon as you've hit the last one. Once you've gone through 2 levels in each castle, you're off to the next one, complete with a change of graphics and enemies. There are some repetitions from episode to episode, but really impressively few considering the size of the game. Your movement is based on grid squares like in the Duke Nukem engine, but it's only noticeable if you're really looking for it. The game plays fast enough for it not to be an issue for the most part, and when you jump, the movement is smoothed out so there's no weird uncomfortable gravity like in Cosmo. One of the most notable things about the way this game behaves is that you won't find monsters just scuttling about the place. Instead, when you walk into certain invisible triggers, groups of them will teleport in with only a few magic sparks and a telltale whoosh sound as a warning. If you run off the screen, they'll vanish and appear again when you come back. This can happen even if you're in the middle of a tricky jump over spikes and have no choice but to land among them. This is pretty unfair from a game design perspective and bloody annoying from a human perspective. Eventually, you learn to be cautious, but you'll still take hits that are very difficult to see coming, and you can't always avoid damage from the game's other obstacles either, which is top of the list of annoying level design decisions. There are also some situations where you can get stuck if you're particularly inept, such as falling down this lift shaft. In situations like these, you have to restart the level, an option thankfully provided by the game so you don't have to reload an earlier save. For a wizard, Hocus knows disappointingly few spells. The sort of lightning zap you see him using here is the only permanent weapon he has throughout the game, but I suppose that's why he's an apprentice. When you start each level, you can only fire one bolt on screen at a time and have to hunt for upgrades to that, but most of the later levels seem to realise that this is too restrictive and will hand you one or two upgrades right at the beginning. For other special powers, you have to rely on the potions that are scattered around the castles. The most common of these grants you an extremely satisfying rapid fire ability that cuts through enemies a lot faster. You just have to remember that Hocus's constant flashing doesn't mean he's invincible. You can also find one that gives you powerful fireballs, but only 3 at a time, and a super jump potion that gives you just one large jump the next time you hit the button after you open it. These aren't usually placed in a way so that you can't complete the level if you accidentally waste them, but there are a couple that are essential. The fourth type of potion is called Warp, and it causes Hocus to curl up into a ball Samus style and hover to a predetermined destination on the level. These are usually used to access secret treasure rooms and are semi-hidden. I say semi because all of this game's secrets are behind very visibly different tiles and could hardly be more obvious if there were a large flashing neon sign above them saying this is a secret. The levels are a lot more interactive than in the other side-scrollers, by which I mean that many of the set pieces involve adding platforms or removing walls to continue. Each castle is full of switches that affect the surrounding environment, some of which work alone and others which need to be set in combination. For the rows of multiple switches, there's never any hint as to what the combination is, you just have to work your way past them by fiddling around until something happens, in an attitude to puzzle design pioneered by Myst the year before. Occasionally, you'll see more inspired ideas being used, like a key to a treasure room being visible at the start of a level, but having to find 4 hidden switches to remove the wall and get to it. Hocus Pocus is a pretty looking game and has some really memorable music, but it does have its problems as well. The way the levels are based around hunting for crystals gives them the opportunity to be non-linear, but often they're too big to be able to mentally map them easily, and you find yourself wandering around looking for the one passage you haven't been down yet. Some of these passages are also pretty repetitive, involving very long sequences of just jumping over identical platforms, items and not falling into the lava below, then having to turn around and go all the way back. And while there are tons of different graphics for the levels and enemies, there isn't much change in the enemy behaviour throughout. There are flying things that twitch about at random and earthbound ones that scuttle despondently back and forth. Some of them might shoot at you, but that's really about it. But really, this game has a lot of charm to it, and it's easy to play it for a long time. Something about it just feels nice, and for that it's easy to overlook its flaws in level design. It also has a wonderful dry sense of humour about itself. The story is great, especially if you read the summaries of all the episodes, which reveal things like the ultimate final boss's vendetta against the council having initially been sparked by an argument about what type of cutlery to get for the dining room. Moonlight Software only did two other non-Apogee games, a couple of much lower rent titles called Clyde's Adventure and Clyde's Revenge, but as simple as this game is, I would definitely have liked to have seen more from them. Mystic Towers is a game from another Australian developer, this time Animation FX. It was a sequel to a game they'd made the previous year, but this was their only release published by Apogee. Unlike the fresh-faced young heroes that star in the majority of games, this time you play as Baron Baldric, a revolting old man in the early stages of mummification whose familial powers of wizardry are the only hope to save the kingdom. After receiving some noise complaints from the local villagers, he's got to venture into the monster-filled Lazarine Towers built by his ancestor and clear them out. The game uses an isometric perspective and is in a unique style for Apogee, owing a lot to the action-adventure games on the Spectrum like Nightlore or Solstice, which I played somewhere on my channel several millenniums ago. As Baldric, you've got to venture through each tower's puzzles and traps in search of the monster generator at its heart. Once you've found and destroyed it, you have to clear out the remaining monsters, then find the key that will let you back out again. As you would expect from a company with a name like Animation FX, the graphics have a lot of character and attention to detail in them. Baldric has a lot of different idle animations and quirks, and the monsters are varied and imaginative. The light-hearted, cartoony look of the games we've looked at in previous videos is seeming increasingly further away as we go. This one takes a moodier and more subdued approach, playing with a palette in order to shroud some of the rooms in darkness until you find a way to light the overhead, somehow electric torches. The background music is atmospheric rather than melodic, aided by using mod format files like in Halloween Harry, and I think several people who watch this channel will be able to recognise the instrument set as being the same one that was used by the ZZT semi-successor Megazooks. In the atmosphere department, I would like to give special mention to this room where you're suddenly plunged into darkness and then set upon by a lightning-fast puppet nurse straight out of Silent Hill. I'm surprised the Baron survived because I'm 30 and it gave me a heart attack. The game has a bit of an RPG-like feel in making you keep track of what seems like hundreds of different gauges. There's a lot going on here, so I'll try to explain the game mechanics by taking you around the screen. Starting on the top right, you've got your lives. Generously, you start a game with 9 of them. Next to that is the count of monsters that are alive in the tower. You can fight and destroy the monsters at any time, but as long as the generator still exists, it will gradually create new monsters to replace the ones you've taken out. This area also shows an icon representing the nearest monster to you, and its current health. Your own health bar takes up most of the right-hand side of the screen and acts as you would expect. If it hits 0, you lose a life, but you're restarted in exactly the same place. Below that, you have a map which shows the layout of the floor of the tower you're on, with your current position highlighted along with ladders for moving up and down. The magic display is towards the lower right. This shows an icon for the spell you're currently using, as well as the number of them you have, and for offensive magic, the staff power bar to the left shows how powerful that spell is. Along the bottom of the display, you can see on-screen buttons that allow you to control the game using the mouse if you feel like making things difficult for yourself. It's nice that they gave the option, but I can't imagine anyone using it by choice because it's just so cumbersome to navigate or do anything with them. The bottom left corner of the screen shows several things. The diagram of the tower shows your current floor. Every level in the game has 5 of them, and the floors with monsters on them will be shaded in red. This is particularly useful towards the end of each level, where you have to find and clear out the remaining monsters. Next to that, the number of coins you have is shown. You can find these scattered about the towers, and if you shove them into the slots you can find in the walls, you'll be rewarded with extra spell pickups. This box also shows the keys you've picked up. Unlike in other games, using a key won't inexplicably disintegrate it, and once you've picked up one colour of key, you'll be able to use any keyholes that require that colour any number of times. The scroll at the bottom left gives you messages telling you what spell you've selected or if you're missing a key, and it also alerts you if you're hit by any status effects, such as being drunk or poisoned. Drunkenness causes you to lose control of the Baron for a moment and can just be walked off, but you need to cast a healing spell on yourself or find and eat a mushroom to cure poison. On the left are your food and water gauges. You can find food scattered about the towers, though less of them as you get further in the game, and sometimes monsters drop it as well. You'll also find fountains throughout the levels, either set into the walls or standing in the middle of the rooms. When your food and water levels are healthy, you'll slowly regain health, but if either of them drop below a certain level, you'll lose health over time instead. Finally, up at the top left are a couple of things nobody cares about, namely score and the number of the room that you're in. Bulgic's wizardry abilities allow him to use a variety of spells, though he has to find and collect recharges of all except the most basic ice spell. The first five of these are attack spells, which are projectiles that you can use against the monsters. Ice, sulfur, venom, fireball, and lightning have gradually increasing power, but also gradually increasing rarity. The other five spells assist you in other ways. You have a healing spell and one that allows you to use the teleport pads to travel between various points in the tower. Reveal will uncover any harmful traps or hidden treasures in the room, and Levitate allows you to float above the ground, taking you to higher areas if you cast it repeatedly. Finally, the bomb spell is the one that you have to use to destroy the generator. There are typically only one or two of these in each level, and they can only be used when standing in front of it. In a rather nice touch, the game will switch you back to offensive spells automatically after a couple of seconds, so that you have them ready if a monster comes up behind you. The controls can take a bit of getting used to due to the game's isometric viewpoint. The up key is used to walk up towards the top right of the screen, but the team thoughtfully allowed the diagonals on the number pad to be used as well if you prefer those. Oddly, the other controls can be confusing because of how simple they are. Your action button is very context sensitive and can be used to pick an object up, drink from a fountain, interact with buttons or switches or use keys, and to cast magic. Often I found myself jumping forward by accident when a monster suddenly appeared because my computer game muscle memory just wasn't expecting the magic button to be the same as the one I had been using to examine the rest of the room. Even once you've found the right button, the combat can be a little weird and awkward. It's sometimes difficult to line yourself up with an enemy effectively, but you can try encouraging them towards the edges of rooms to help. The monsters are intelligent and will attempt to run away if they're close to defeat, so sometimes you need to use the doors strategically to prevent their escape. Because the later monsters use extremely damaging projectiles, it's also wise to use the rest of the environment against them, such as bomb and fireball traps, rather than trying to take them on directly. The game's explanation of how its levels are laid out is needlessly confusing. The help says that there are 6 towers in the game and you can play them on 2 different difficulty levels, but I'll do you a favour, there are 12 towers in this game. 6 of these are designated as Apprentice Towers and 6 as Master Towers. There's a gradually increasing difficulty curve throughout the levels, but the Master Towers introduce an entirely new set of challenges once you get to them. As well as obvious things like the enemies being faster and more dangerous, you'll find that you don't get an overhead map by default. You have to find scraps of it around the levels to fill out the maps of each floor. The pedestal on which the exit key appears is no longer in the starting room, and becomes a third landmark that you have to hunt through the tower for and plan your escape route around, and the layouts of the towers are more difficult to navigate in general. Unlike every other Apogee game since the release of Craws, there are no episodes this time. The shareware version which I used to have let you play only 2 towers, which were Rim Tower and Rim Fortress. The other towers stand noticeably apart from them, with different backgrounds and completely new enemies, so the game definitely justifies its additional length. If anything, I would say it feels a tiny bit too short. 12 doesn't really sound like a lot of levels, but even the earlier ones take about 15 minutes each to complete, and possibly more depending on how good you are at finding your way through the labyrinthine set of rooms. It's worth mentioning that I found the game wasn't set up all that well in the anthology, and found the performance of the sound and music much better if I set the cycle count down to about 5,000. Even though the option doesn't have an effect on DOSBox, I also saw that the game was also somewhat ahead of its time in providing the option to play in 1610 widescreen, which I didn't even know was supported by any monitors that had been invented at the time. In any case, Mystic Towers is a really well-made, interesting and unique game and well worth looking at, especially for the title screen music, which I just think might be among the greatest mod songs ever written. Wacky Wheels is Super Mario Kart. Planet Strike is the second game to star Blake Stone, though this one doesn't mention his name in the title. Alright, I'll go back and take a proper look. Super Mario Kart, which this game isn't, but I'll get to it, was a huge deal when it came out on the Super Nintendo in 1992. Its pseudo 3D way of showing the track was made possible by a graphics mode on the SNES called Mode 7, which allowed programmers to scale and rotate the game's background layer, and with a bit of hardware trickery they could also skew it into the screen so that it looked like it was lying flat. F-Zero and Mario Kart used this technique to project the image of a racetrack as if it were going off into the distance in front of the player, and an image to fill out the horizon completes the illusion. In 1993, programmer Andy Edwardson experimented with trying to mimic this effect while doing work for a Belgian company called Copysoft. He got an engine test together and the company got quite excited about it, being blessed with an unsoft disc-like ability to see something that had potential, but he and artist Sean Gadala ultimately decided to make a deal with Apogee to distribute the game instead. You only have to take a glance at it to recognise that this game was based heavily on Mario Kart. That game had managed to invent an entire subgenre of racing games single-handedly, and many other developers in the future would attempt to replicate its style with short, fast tracks and weapon-based gameplay. This particular one is about a collection of escapees from the zoo racing about on lawnmowers. You get a choice of 8 assorted mammals, although I don't know if any of the racers have any practical difference between them. Indeed, it's impressive that in a multi-species world, all the animals seem to be on equal footing, with the notable exception of hedgehogs, which are casually treated as ammunition. When you run these hapless, spiny creatures over, you'll get 4 more that you can fire in a straight line in front of you, which can slow opponents down for a moment if your aim is good. You can also pick up maybe 2 or 3 other weapons, like bombs that drop behind you, or a flame that fans out in front of you, but for the most part you'll be using the hedgehogs, and your count of them carries over tracks in a championship, so it's a decent idea to save them up. Sticking so closely to dumbfire projectiles means Wacky Wheels lack some of the variety of the game it's inspired by, but to be honest, it's quite refreshing not to have the potential to suddenly be hit by an unavoidable spiky blue shell followed by 14 other lesser weapons when you're about to cross the finish line. In fact, I'm not entirely sure if the computer players use the weapons at all. I don't think I ever had it happen to me. However, if you do want the agony of being in first place and then ruining it all in an instant, this game is more than happy to provide it. There's an impressive amount of content in this game. The version in the anthology is the full game together with a bonus pack, and you get 30 racetracks in 6 championships and 12 battle arenas with this in all. On all of these, 3 difficulty levels are available, and on the highest setting you really have to play dirty to have a hope of finishing in first place. There's also a separate mode where you scoot around an arena blasting ducks on wheels, if that's the sort of thing that takes your fancy. However, the tracks don't really feel very unique, being based on just a few different kinds of appearances and not really being big enough to have much of a distinct feel to them. The driving mechanics don't really have a lot of character either. Mostly you're just scooting your way around the tracks by accelerating and turning left and right, and tight turns are achieved by hitting the handbrake key, which spins you around more or less on the spot. There isn't really much of a sense of momentum, and the limited frame rate and jerky turning mean that it's often difficult to keep up with what's going on. There's a dope fish. Something else that I find irritating is that it's possible to have a bad crash with an obstacle and lose the level instantly. It doesn't happen very often, and it isn't as if the tracks take very long, but it's annoying to have to restart because of one mistake. A karting game wouldn't be a karting game without multiplayer, and impressively, Wacky Wheels can handle drawing 2 player screens simultaneously, making it the first Apogee game to be playable by more than one person at a time. You can opt to play alone or with computer-controlled opponents. Taking it a step further, the game also supports online multiplayer, or as close as you could get to it in those days by using a modem or serial link cable, with a protocol called Combat. That's combat with 2 M's, as not in Mortal Kombat. In a rather unique feature, you can hit the function keys to send graphical messages to your opponents, including the slightly surprising giant Red Devil's bottom that you can see on the left. Overall, while the game was extremely technically impressive at the time, it hasn't really aged very well, something that's common among early games that pushed the limits of what computers could do with 3-dimensional displays. I actually wonder if using the Wolfenstein 3D engine might have made the game run a bit more smoothly, as we've seen it could be goaded into doing floor textures, but perhaps it had limitations on the size of the image that would need to be used, or something else I don't know about that would have made it unsuitable. It was just an idea. Planet Strike is the second game to star Blake Stone, though this one doesn't mention his name in its title. It's the second and only other release ever made by Jam Productions. At first glance, the games are pretty similar, going around blasting mutants and collecting several thousand more gold bars than a human being could plausibly carry, but this one adds a couple of further enhancements that smooth the gameplay experience a bit. The story is the same as before. After escaping capture in Aliens of Gold, Dr. Goldfire has retreated to an abandoned facility that wasn't absolutely razed to the ground by Blake previously, which has given him time to start churning out a more varied array of mutants. Eventually, Captain I'm So British on His Bloody Toodlepip Crikey traces him and sets off to get to the heart of the complex and have a stern word with him once again. It was at this moment when looking through the story that I realised Dr. Goldfire looks exactly like my old woodwork teacher, making him the most terrifying Apogee villain ever by a mile. A few more elements have been added compared to the first game. Immediately, you can recognise that the game is darker compared to the fully lit, bright and cheery look it had before, with corridors fading into the distance and a couple of light sources cutting through the gloom. It's still mostly straight action, and you won't find any of Doom's scary dark corridors, but the game does take on a sudden tension horror aspect later on when you find yourself in a set of corridors with naked blue statues, some of which will silently come to life once you turn your back on them. Enemies can also be hidden behind doors that are locked from your side so they can leap out and surprise you, so the levels feel a bit more jumpy than they used to be. The objective of the game has been changed as well. Instead of being centred around a lift and repeatedly finding the red access card to get to further floors, this time you have to unlock a network of teleporter destinations by finding a fission detonator in each level and bringing it to the security cube to destroy it. Between each level, you go out to the map of the complex that looks a bit like the Crystal Maze, with a display showing how much of each level you've mapped and explored, and being able to flip back to previous areas gives you more of an incentive to go back and look further at the ones you're obviously missing pieces of. A big new mechanic is in the auto map that you now constantly have on the screen in your status bar, an absolute godsend for being able to navigate around smoothly without having to toggle back and forward in the pause menu. But it does more than that as well. It has three different zoom levels, which show enemies and informants at medium zoom and will identify secret push walls at maximum zoom. All of these modes require power, which is restored with pickups that are scattered around the level similar to ammunition. Using the larger zoom modes will drain your map energy a lot faster, so you have to be judicious about where you're scanning for secrets and keep an eye on your power to make sure it doesn't run out. This makes the secret finding process much more satisfying than in previous games, where it was mostly about running along walls bashing the spacebar, although the limited power feature does sometimes make me feel like I should be watching the map feverishly to track the movements of a possessed robotic chicken in pants who's forcefully trying to serve me a cupcake. There are absolutely piles of different enemies, although some of them are recognisable as redrawings of the original ones with the exact same behaviour. The guards have been redrawn into various species of aliens, leaving the lab-coated technicians and the informants as the sole humans in the levels. The bosses from the first game all come back as part of this mutated menagerie, but they've been demoted severely since their appearances in the first game, and all go down in a matter of seconds. Many of the enemies also come in cloaked versions as well, barely visible at a distance, which can really help them surprise you and take about half your health off instantly at point-blank range. On top of that, there seem to be slightly too many of them that use hitscan attacks, meaning weapons that hit you instantly with no visible projectile, so it's sometimes very difficult to ascertain where an attack is coming from when you're under fire. Similar to the enemies, the weapons are all the same as in the first game, but have been completely redrawn as they hover in front of your face, though they retain their brighter sprites in the game. A bobbing effect has also been added to simulate walking, making it look less like you're just gliding about the corridors on wheels, though to me this somehow highlights the weird way he's holding his weapons by protruding them directly out the front of his chest like a Dalek. There is one new weapon, the anti-plasma cannon, which is a gigantuan double-barrel thing that you can fire about 12 times before it completely drains your battery pack. Like the first game, all the weapons share the same type of ammunition, so with the exception of only bringing out this one for special occasions, there really isn't any reason to select the lower weapons ever again once you've found the higher up ones, and you collect the rapid assault weapon just a few steps into the first level, making the first two of them largely irrelevant. While I'm on the subject, this weapon is perfectly sufficient for almost all situations, downing the enemies in about 5 shots and with a good ammunition consumption while it's doing it, so the fourth weapon doesn't have all that much of an incentive to use it either. In common with several of the games Apogee released this year, the concept of episodes has been discarded. This time, Blake has to make it through one run of 20 levels compared to the original's total of 60. It sounds like this would make the game too short, but really it feels much more comfortable. It has the right amount of content to justify its length and a lot of secret areas to discover in addition to the main quest. So even though I hadn't played the sequel growing up and have no nostalgia for it, I enjoyed this one a lot and was compelled to play it all the way through to the end. It was a nice surprise in fixing several things from the original game that I hadn't even realised were wrong. Boppin is a weird game. That alone isn't the reason that it hasn't been included in the anthology, but as a result of the author's game design philosophy, it caused some bad blood between them and Apogee. I'll get more into that later. The authors in question were an outfit called Accursed Toys, consisting of Jennifer Diane Wright and partners. These people would also later become the founders of Happy Puppy Games, which was the most popular games and shareware site in the late 90s and early 2000s. Their contribution to the Apogee line was a puzzle game, something that hadn't been seen in the lineup since Paganitzu all the way back in 1991. The storyline is pretty interesting and a little more profound than many of the genetic experimentation let's go and blow up mutants approaches. Your protagonists, a pair of stylish pieces of geometry called Yeet and Boik, are in their Wreck-It Ralph style Dream Space arcade when disaster strikes, all the enemies have suddenly been removed from the games. Their arcade protagonist friends quickly appear to tell them that the infamous sickeningly nice hero, a rabbit who is honestly called Sweetie Honey Buns, has removed all the enemies from games and left players with nothing to do, so in a twist from the usual heroics, this time you're tasked with freeing the enemies. You do this by walking around the single screen levels, picking up tiles and then throwing them diagonally upwards at the other tiles that litter the levels. If you hit another tile of the same type, they'll both disappear, and if the arrangement of blocks you made is in one of four special patterns, then you'll also score a bonus and free a game's monster. It isn't necessary to go out of your way to form these patterns, and sometimes it takes a bit too much effort, but the little reward animation is nice as there are many different enemies to discover, many of which are nods to other things in games or culture. In a nice touch, it's possible for two players to participate side by side, something that's named in the help files as a core value of the authors to make games a social activity. Something I also want to highlight is that the game has a truly astonishing number of environments. I think it's reasonable to say that most people would have drawn a few tile sets and swapped around every 5 or 10 levels or something, but Boppin uses completely unique graphics for almost all 160 of its levels. This is a spectacular amount of effort, and none of them feel like they were just knocked together to fill a space. There are all sorts of levels themed on things like Lego, Pac-Man, an architectural blueprint, one in space, a handwritten one on a notebook, and just some pleasantly colourful abstract environments as well. The mechanics of throwing the blocks can take some getting used to. They'll bounce off walls and ceilings, but will smash on floors, and also if they collide with a non-matching tile. When this happens, you lose one of your pieces of health. It's sometimes difficult to follow the path of where a block is going to go, especially when you're dealing with the repulsors in the walls that will change their direction, but conveniently you can use the tile-based nature of some of the level backgrounds to help guide you. It's also confusing that blocks only explode in set patterns and a match won't necessarily clear all adjacent blocks. It took me a while on this level to realise I needed to arrange the blocks in the shape of a cross first and couldn't clear them separately. The only real downfall of the game comes in the bosses that appear at the end of each episode, which are frankly surprisingly free of imagination. You appear in a narrow level with your rabbit of interest sliding around the screen in a bouncing ball pattern, and you just have to chuck the generating items at him or her until they're eventually defeated. This takes absolutely ages even with two players, and there really isn't any need to engage your brain on them. You just have to keep hiding where the boss is unlikely to get to and plug away until they eventually go down. All of this sounds perfectly okay so far, but you'll begin to see the underlying strangeness of the game the first time you run out of lives, whereupon your happy triangular character will pull a gun or sword out and commit suicide as graphically as 16x16 pixels will allow. It isn't as if Apogee shied away from violence before, but these sequences feel absurdly out of place in a game that's otherwise very cheerful and friendly, even if they might look laughably crude by today's standards. Accursed Toys' mottos are "Determined to Disturb" and "Adult Games for Adult Minds," as explained on the company's logo screen, which depicts their mascot the Deddy Bear in a clearly poor state of health. Accursed Toys say they specifically did this to surprise and challenge the player's attitude to the audience for puzzle games and to make people think about the acceptance of violence in game culture. Apogee disagreed with the blood in the game and requested an altered version, and the authors provided this very reluctantly, sarcastically calling it the politically corrected version on the new pre-game credit screen, and including a command line switch to restore the violence. I'm going to tread carefully here, and I don't want to say that game designers shouldn't be allowed to make the games they want. The rise of independent releases over the last decade has created a great environment for that, but I understand Apogee's position on this issue. It was in their interest to have a game that was as inclusive as possible, and I don't feel that the blood contributes much to the enjoyment of a pleasant puzzle game, and the same goes for the massive diatribes about the nature of mankind and the corporation available in the game's help screens. However, saying that politics and thought have no place in the game is to stifle what the designer intended, and if I am saying that, then I might as well give up all the respect I have for anyone, delete my morals, and then go and join Gamergate. My personal view is that the sequences do the opposite of the author's intention, and make the game violent and potentially controversial, even though it could have been an example of a game which stood on its own merits. But if you'd like to hear Jennifer Diane Wright's side of the story, there's a lengthy interview at Classic DOS Games which I'll put in the video description. If things happened as they're said in that interview, I find it disappointing that Apogee reacted the way they did to Boppin and didn't give it the attention it deserved because of their relationship with its author. It's certainly offbeat, but it's a really well-made and fairly unique puzzle game with some original ideas. Happily, the game is now freeware, and a Windows-compatible version of it is available from Jenny's own site at jennyverse.com, which restores everything to how she meant it to be. I didn't have much luck getting it running on Windows 7, but the DOS version is also there. Rise of the Triad was released during the last days of 1994, and was actually the only entirely Apogee-developed game the company published this year. For the first time, a dedicated internal group was set up to create it, and they called themselves the DIP, or Developers of Incredible Power. This group included Tom Hall, who had jumped ship from id to Apogee after he disagreed with the dark and violent direction that id's games were taking. Given that, it's sort of surprising that he ended up doing this instead, another first-person shooter that prides itself so much on just how many flying body parts his engine could handle. The game started off as a sequel to Wolfenstein 3D, about saving the world from a villainous post-World War II group called the Triad. This was a joint project with id Software, but like the third Commander Keen series, it became a casualty when Romero and company suddenly found themselves in the middle of an overwhelming success with Doom, a truly industry-changing game, as you can tell because I seem to have mentioned it at least twice as much as Apogee in these videos. So the Wolfenstein part of the name was dropped, and Tom Hall took over direction of the game. When he was working on the initial design for Doom, he had wanted to make it much more story-based with a selection of different characters for the player to choose from, and he carried many of those ideas over into this game instead. In the end, it became a game about a group of five United Nations agents who are scouting a monastery on San Nicolas Island because of cult activity there that may lead to an attack on Los Angeles. They're spotted, their boat is destroyed along with any chance of backup, and faced with no other options, they suddenly become Team America, load up and charge into the fortress themselves. You have to make your way into the heart of the base and foil the plot to destroy the world, and so on and so forth. You can choose to play as any one of these five characters, who all have different strengths and weaknesses. Lorelei Knee, for example, is super fast but short on health points, whereas human combat vehicle Doug Vent can absorb anything up to a Range Rover crashing into him, but lacks a bit in the pace department. Amusingly, the height of your viewpoint above the ground also changes per character. Honestly, the differences between them are small, but the selection on offer makes the game pretty unusual for the time in being able to play as characters of different genders, races, and nationalities. As you'll have noticed, Rise of the Triad has a distinctive digitised photo appearance similar to Mortal Kombat, and shares its property of being a giant pile of bizarre in-jokes loosely held together in the shape of a game. Despite the blood and violence, it takes absolutely none of itself seriously. When you're not bouncing about on trampolines like Super Mario trying to collect floating Ankh coins, you'll find pickups like the oh-so-itchy asbestos armour that protects you from fire, or a god mode that literally turns you into a blue holy fireball-spitting god, complete with sounds courtesy of Tom Hall, who's doing an impression of the noise he said John Romero used to make when he no-clipped through the walls in Doom. The counterpart to this is the dog mode, which turns you equally invincible but with a bite attack and the ability to sneak under low walls. On certain days of the year like Halloween and Christmas, the game got even weirder, adding hats celebrating the date's holiday to the loading screen and changing the first level's music to things like this interpretation of God Rest You Merry Gentlemen. The weapon system is pretty unusual even when you're in your normal human shape. There are an impressive 12 or so of them at a guess, but there's a limit to the ones you can carry at one time in a way almost reminiscent of more modern on-rails shooters. Weapon slots 1, 2, and 3 are occupied by bullet weapons. The first is your single pistol, the second is for dual pistols, which you find 4 feet into the first level, so you'll never use your solo one, and the third is the MP40, a machine gun which fires much more rapidly, and all of these have infinite ammunition, so you'll never use your dual pistols once you've found that. The fourth slot is where things get interesting. That's the space for your missile weapon, and you can only carry one of them at a time. When you run into another, you'll drop the one you're carrying, so you have to manage your ammunition and the type you want to have on hand carefully. There's an impressive variety of these to find, starting with standard bazookas and heatseekers, up to more unusual ones like the junk missile that spew missiles all over the place, or the flame wall which will toast any enemies in its path if you aim it at the ground in front of them. Later on in the game, once you're in the heart of the fortress, you'll start discovering magic weapons. The dark staff, which obliterates any evil monks played by musician Lee Jackson that happened to waddle in front of it, and in a truly inspired touch, the Excalibat, a scanned-in photo of a baseball bat masquerading as a lightsaber that can be used to knock enemies about or to unleash a mighty arc of fiery baseballs when charged up. One of the things that the developers of Incredible Power especially wanted to innovate in was the field of multiplayer. Specifically to beat Doom's maximum of 4, they put together a network mode that could support up to 11 players in one game. This was also the first FPS to offer so many different game types natively, something that I don't think was done again until Unreal Tournament. As well as the standard FPS interaction of firing rockets at each other, players could choose a fairly massive selection of games. Among them are team-based games like Capture the Triad, tag games where you have to pursue targets over the map, and a non-violent collector mode where you have no weapons and have to race to collect the most triad insignias scattered around the map. In all of these, it also supported a system called Remote Ridicule, which allowed you to play taunts or record your own messages to other players, an early form of the modern feature of live multiplayer chat. Something unusual, by which I mean unusual in a different way from all the other madness contained in Rise of the Triad, is that the registered version contains none of the shareware levels. The full game is a 4-episode adventure called Dark War, and the shareware one is a completely different, shorter map set called The Hunt Begins, so both are worth playing. On top of that, there's a bonus pack called Extreme Rise of the Triad with a further 40 levels, many of which use quirks of the game engine to make a different experience. You actually have all of these in the Anthology version of the game, but I didn't notice this until I happened to look at the game's install folder. You can't get to them through the Windows launcher, and you have to use the game setup utility to select a level set. In the end, the team were aware that using the enhanced Wolfenstein 3D engine was going to make the game feel a little dated by this point, with its square rooms and fixed-height floors. You can have tall buildings, but you can only raise the player off the ground by using these floating pad objects. With that in mind, it's wonderful to see that they just had so much fun with it within those limitations, making end-of-episode baddies by stapling a load of cardboard to the boss's executive office chair, the way that it cheerfully makes a comment as to the datedness of your computer hardware when you put the screen size all the way down, and the way that when you step into a lift, there's a very small random chance of this happening. When it came out, it was definitely in the shadow of Doom, but it set itself apart with its different, brighter and funnier attitude. It's a great example of why my temporarily impossible dream job is to be a game developer in the early 90s, when small teams really could come out with classics like these that are genuinely fun to play. The soundtrack is also fantastic, a catchy sort of jazzy rock trumpety collection of pieces that I'm not even sure how to classify. Towards the end of its development, the team actually had the option of moving to the more advanced build engine that was in development at Apogee for the new Duke Nukem game, but in the end they decided not to, to avoid the game taking many more years to come out. In fact, while putting this video together, I looked at a Gamasutra article written in early 1995, and it praised the team's development agility as Apogee adjusted their approach to development, saying that their first step is to use in-house development teams, similar to Tom Hall's 9-person crew, that will be able to flexibly build games in a reasonable time frame. And if there is a greater example of a confident statement coming back to bite you in the end, it doesn't come to mind.